Hello students, today I've come up with the next part of the chapter coordination compounds from class 12 syllabus. So as I have told in the last video that today we will discuss about the color of the coordination compounds. Okay, so let's start with it. Okay, so how does color develop? We know that white light consists of Ritzier colors, violet, indigo, blue, green, yellow, orange, red. Okay, so actually what happens in these compounds is that, for example, I am taking that this is the T2G set and this is the EG set. The energy difference between the T2G and EG set is not very large. The T2G set and the EG set do not have very large energy distance. So, generally, what happens? Let's consider that there are 4 electrons in the T2G set. Light ray the compound will absorb the light and the energy of the photons will be absorbed by the electrons at the lower energy state, and this and one of the electrons, by absorbing the energy of this photon, will get excited to the higher energy set. Like I am saying that this electron is being excited to the higher energy state. Okay? But remember one thing, that electrons cannot remain in the higher energy state for a much longer time. So a time will come when the electron will again return back to the lower energy state, and on returning back to the lower energy state, it will emit energy, and this energy that it will emit, that energy will either remain in the visible region of the electromagnetic electromagnetic radiation, or in ultraviolet or infrared. But if the energy of emitted by this electron remains in the visible region, then this molecule will show you the color. So let's see this phenomenon with the example. Okay, so let's come to the one of the examples. Okay, so I am considering the molecule chromium H2O whole 6 3 plus. Okay, chromium H2O whole 6 3 plus. See, chromium 3 plus is a D3 system. So it has 3 electrons in the T2G set. Okay, 3 electrons in the T2G set. So on absorbing light, on absorbing the energy of the photon of the light, one electron will get excited to the EG set. So on absorbing light, what happens? That one electron is transmitted to the EG set. This happens Okay, now chromium generally is a D3 system, and water is a weak field ligand. Water is not a very strong field ligand. So the crystal field splitting or the energy difference between the EG and the T2G set is not very high. The energy difference is low. So this electron will absorb that much energy only, that which is required for it to get excited to the EG set. Means the energy difference between the T2G and the EG set will be the energy that is absorbed by this electron to get excited to the EG set. So since water is a weak field ligand, the crystal field splitting is less. So the energy will be also less. So this electron will absorb the color from the visible spectrum only, but that color which will have a lower energy. So generally chromium H2O whole 6 3 plus, this electron will absorb yellow color. This electron will absorb yellow color. But you know one thing, that the color of chromium H2O whole 6 3 plus is not yellow. It is violet, means around violet you can say. The color between violet, indigo, blue, like this. We can call it violet blue. Okay. The color of chromium H2O whole 6 3 plus is violet blue. But the electron from a T2G set will absorb the light of frequency around something which will give you the color yellow. Means it will absorb light of it will absorb yellow light which has a definite frequency. Means that frequency which is required for exciting this electron from the T2G set to the EG set. But this one has a violet blue color. Why? Because I have told you the phenomenon that it absorbs a particular color of light having a particular energy that is required to excite the electron. The electron will go to the higher excited state, but it will not be able to remain in the higher excited state for a longer time. It will have to return back, leaving the energy or emitting energy. So if if yellow light is absorbed by the T2G electron of chromium H2O whole 6 3 plus, then it will transmit its complementary color. There is a wheel known as the color wheel. I will attach the color wheel in your study material. In that color wheel, the colors which are opposite to one another, those are the complementary colors. So the color complementary to yellow is violet blue. So if it absorbs yellow, it will transmit the color which is violet blue, and the color which is transmitted, that color only, is known as the color of that compound. So this has a violet blue color. Okay. Now I'll come to another compound, which is the same chromium NH3 whole 6 3 plus. So this is also, since amine ligand is a neutral ligand, so this is also a D3 system. The same thing will happen here also. But you know the color of this compound is yellow. Why? Now ammonia is a much stronger field ligand as compared to that of water. Ammonia is a much stronger field ligand, or you can say the amine ligand is a much stronger field ligand than aqua ligand. So the crystal phase splitting will be more. So the energy difference between the T2G and the EG sets will be greater. So this electron have to absorb the light, having the light which is associated to a much higher energy. And that higher energy light is generally violet blue color. So it absorbs this violet blue color, and hence it will transmit the complementary color of violet blue, which is yellow. So it absorbs violet blue color and transmits the color which is yellow. So this one is violet blue in color, whereas this one is yellow in color. This is how you have to explain the color of different compounds. Okay, so this is all about crystal field theory. Now there are certain limitations of crystal field theory. I will mention the limitations in your study material. Okay, so one of the limitations is that here the bond between the metal and the ligand is partly covalent in nature, but in this crystal field theory it is completely purely electrostatic. Means it is considered that the metal ligand bond, it is considered that the metal ligand bond is purely electrostatic, but basically the metal ligand bond is partially covalent in nature. Okay, it does not able to explain the relative strengths of different ligands. Means in which complex, where how much strength of ligand is taken, it is unable to explain that. Here it stresses mainly on the metal orbitals. The ligand orbitals are not considered. Also, another point is that in the crystal field theory, only we are talking about the d orbitals, not about the s or px, py, pz orbitals of the metal. Neither we are talking about the ligand pi orbitals. Since we are not talking about the ligand pi orbitals, again the pi back donation or pi back bonding cannot be explained by the help of crystal field theory. So the carbonyl compounds or the bonding of the metal with the carbonyl cannot be explained by crystal field theory. Okay, so after this we generally have the molecular orbital theory, the ligand field theory, orbital diagram. All these things, if you read chemistry in BSc and MSc, will be able to know. Otherwise, not at all. Okay. So this is all about crystal field theory. Now I just want to tell you about a small portion of coordination compounds, which is the stability. Stability of coordination compounds. There are two types of stability. One is the kinetic stability and the other one is the thermodynamic stability. So what is kinetic stability? Kinetic stability is how much speed is required for the transformation that will lead to the attainment of equilibrium. Means basically the speed of the reaction. And thermodynamic stability means the extent to which a complex is transformed into or formed from other complex under certain conditions when the system has already attained equilibrium. Means this is the speed to attain equilibrium, and this represents the extent, this is the measure of the extent to which a complex is either transformed into another complex or substances which together will form a complex, but it has already attained equilibrium. So these are the two types of stability. Now how will you find out the stability? Okay, this is a metal, this is a ligand. They will together form a complex ML. Okay, This amyl will react with another ligand to form a complex amyl plus cell gives amyl 2. This amyl 2 will again react with this ligand to form amyl 3. Amyl 3 will again react to form amyl 4. See, in order to form the complex amyl 4 from M and L, we can carry out these 4 steps, either this or we can directly form the compound ML4 by reacting 4 moles of the ligand with the metal. Okay, so when we are performing this stepwise reactions, we will have stepwise rate constant for each of these reactions. You know the calculation of rate constant from kinetics. So for this it is K1. K1 is equal to concentration of the complex divided by concentration of the metal and concentration of the ligand. For the second is K2, concentration of ML2 by concentration of ML into concentration of L. For this it is K3, concentration of ML3 by concentration of ML2 into concentration of L, and this is K4, concentration of ML4 divided by concentration of ML3 by concentration of L. Okay, these are the stepwise rate constants if we carry out this reaction stepwise. Now for this reaction, since this is a total, this is a one step reaction, this will have a overall rate constant which is denoted by beta 4. Since there are 4 ligands, beta 4 is equal to ML4 into concentration of metal into concentration of ligand to the power 4. Okay, so this is the overall rate constant, this is the stepwise rate constant. Now if we relate the overall rate overall rate constant with the stepwise rate constant, then overall rate constant is equal to K1 into K2 into K3 into K4. So this is the relation between the stepwise rate constants and the overall rate constant. Okay. Now, this was a specified complex ML4. Now if we take a general complex M plus NL giving MLN, for the formation of this complex we will have beta n is equal to K1 into K2 into K3 into ... into Kn. Means n is the number of ligands. Okay, so this is the general relationship between the overall rate constant. This is the overall rate constant. And these are the stepwise rate constants. Okay. So, this is how you will relate the overall step constant with the rate wise step constants. Okay. So this is all about coordination compounds. This was the last video of coordination compounds. From the next day we will we will see that which portions are left in your syllabus. That only we will start with you. Okay, so after completing coordination compounds, I think your syllabus for this upcoming test is completed. Okay, so in the next one online class I'll get tomorrow, in that online class I will teach you the various questions that can come from this chapter. Okay, basically I'll discuss the worksheet. Thank you.